morning, everyone. The Committee on Rules, Federal Foreign, Micronesian Affairs, Human and Natural Resources and Election Reform and Capital District shall come to order for the purposes of hearing two items up for public discussion. First item is Bill Number 86-33-LS, introduced by Vice Speaker Cruz, an act to place the Governor Manuel F.L. Guerrero Building in the Guam Register of Historic Places. And immediately following the public hearing on Bill 86, we will have a status update on the tree ordinance by the Department of Agriculture's Forestry and Soil Resources Division. It's now a few minutes after 9 a.m., so 9:05. And in accordance with the open government law, notices of this hearing were sent to all main media outlets, all senators and stakeholders, 5 days in advance on April 28, 2015. And a second notice was sent on April 30th, 2015. And I'd like to recognize and thank Vice Speaker Cruz for being here and Senator Underwood and Speaker Wombat. Thank you for being here as well. Can I have the sign-up sheet? I'll get the as many people as can make up the first panel, and then I'll recognize the sponsor of the bill to give opening statements. So he would do that before a panel and before the general public. Up to signing up to provide testimony, Senator Cristobal, you indicated written testimony. Will you providing oral testimony as well? Okay, please come forward. Senator Cristobal, Senator Duenas, Mr. Perez, and we can fit Mr. Cameron, so there's four seats and four individuals. Now that the panel is situated, I want to recognize the sponsor of the bill, Senator Cruz, to give an opening statement.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Most of all, I'd like to thank you for the expedited hearing in which you scheduled this, the hearing of this bill that was introduced last week. As you might know, I've done considerable traveling. Some for pleasure, some for work. About 8 years ago, Speaker and I traveled to Okinawa at the very beginning of the buildup. And one of the places that we visited was the palace of the imperial leaders of Okinawa. It's an absolutely beautiful palace. As we were taking the tour, it was made clear to us that it had been completely built from the ground up. The United States, in its quest to win World War II, was very thorough in its demolition of just about every place. In Okinawa, the only original remaining part of the palace was a drain spout that was no bigger than maybe 3 feet by 2 feet. And from that point, they rebuilt the palace all the way back up. I was in Munich a couple of years ago. The Americans did the same thing there. They destroyed every single building in the city save for the cathedral. The Munich Cathedral was the only, I guess they were told not to destroy that, but everything else in the city was destroyed. In Guam, that same thing was true. in the reoccupation, the instructions were to raise the capital city so that there would be no people that could hide in any buildings that could possibly bring harm to the soldiers, like had happened in the invasion of Saipan. So after World War II, Hagania City was completely destroyed. Bulldozers bulldozed all the what was left of the city out to what is now known as Paseo de Susana. Became a huge landfill. All the homes. So after the war, a few families rebuilt their homes in the capital city. Some on the original sites, some using parts that had remained of their original homes. I was very proud of the Guam Preservation Trust a few years ago when they bought the Lujan properties and rebuilt the Lujan house. Sorry they're not here, but I understand that they spent a couple of million dollars in the rebuild. Not only that, but they had exchanged a considerable number of government properties to get that property. As you may know, in driving to or from our offices, we've always had to go past what looks like World War II remnants behind our building. They really weren't. I'm probably dating myself by saying that as a young child, I remember playing in the house directly behind the legislature that's completely covered. It was the home of my sister's godmother, Mrs. Millichamp Nutley. The house next to it, I mean, that house is just completely covered in vines. There's still furniture in it. The house was destroyed in Pamela and has not been rebuilt. Next to it was what for a while was Agania's homeless center, because so many migrants were living in that as a homeless center. I thought that it had been privately owned. I was surprised a few months ago when the police were out there and were evicting the homeless people that had taken shelter in it. Come to find out that that structure that's directly behind the Ada Plaza actually was purchased by Historic Preservation Trust and is scheduled for rebuilding. Historic Preservation Trust had no problem purchasing that piece of property, and to say it looks destroyed would be an understatement. It makes the Guerrero building look like Buckingham Palace by comparison. But Historic Preservation Trust will probably spend several million dollars rebuilding that. During the discussions on the floor last week, one of our colleagues talked about growing up in the home of the late Archbishop Felix Berta Flores. I recognize that house because as a child, we used to stop there to pick up the Diaz kids, Judge Diaz's children, on the way to St. Francis. And that house was in use. It had been rebuilt after the war. It was in use until after Typhoon Pamela. Since its destruction by the typhoon, they haven't been able to rebuild it because Historic Preservation Trust has told them you cannot rebuild unless you comply with the original plans and strict adherence to historical, to history. So that house sits as this eyesore. So Historic Preservation Trust has renovated one eyesore, left three eyesores in the city, and is now the main proponent of the destruction of the demolition of the Garreau building, which is in no way or shape as derelict as the buildings that are being held in the Preservation Trust. How those three homes got on the historic registry, I don't know. When Lujan House was redone, I remember going to the dedication, and the list of personages who had grown up and gone to school at the Guam Academy were listed. But when I, and so they spent $3 million to rebuild it. But when I went through and listed the governors, and especially the Chamorro governors, who governed the Chamorro people for the first time in 400 years from the Guerrero building starting in 1964, I was scoffed at. Who cares? With the capital city of Agana completely destroyed after World War II, we have nothing on in this city that really we can say was here before the war. I want to thank you, Mr. Chairman and Madam Speaker, for the fact that when the effort was made to rebuild or renovate the Guam Congress building, that we tried to be as true to the architectural integrity of the building, and that even the addition that's being put on in the back is going to have the same kind of elongated windows that the main structure had. I know that the cathedral is not an original. Again, dating myself, I was there for the dedication of the cathedral 60 years ago. So I was born before that. And I know that in the more recent past, that Historic Preservation Trust provided several million dollars to the cathedral for some renovations that were being done in the cathedral. But Historic Preservation Trust is unwilling to defend or to place the Guerrero building, from which Manuel Guerrero the first, actually even before him, Joseph Flores, the first appointed Chamorro governor, held office. I was talking to Phil about a month ago, and he kept insisting he remembered visiting his grandfather in the building. And so I said, I guess, and when I looked it up, it was correct that they had finished building it, I think, 59, though the construction started earlier than that. But Governor Flores held office in there. Governor Guerrero held office in there after Typhoon Karen, when Governor Connolly wouldn't come back. He held office there as the appointed governor after that, until Governor Carlos Camacho was appointed. Governor Camacho held office there for the last 3 years of his appointed term, and the full 4 years that he Governor of Guam. Ricky Bedalio served in that building. The first Governor Cowell, Governor Paul Cowell, served in that building. In introducing this piece of legislation, I was hoping that we as a community might want to honor a place where Chamorros were governing themselves from in the historic preservation. I thought that it would have as much historical significance and importance as the childhood home of the first Chamorro Archbishop. I thought it would have as much historical significance as the Lujan House, which was a school where we educated many of our those governors and some senators and Judge Cristobal Duenas. Was this is one of the students in that had gone to school there. So I didn't know, Mr. Chairman. I just thought that we as a community might want to save a building from which we could tell our children, our grandchildren, and their progeny that from that building in the Ganya, for the first time since 1521, a Chamorro governed and ruled over his people. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Vice Speaker. I'll go with the first individual that signed up, but more importantly because she's the only woman on the panel, so Senator Stobel.
Mananas Itzus. Buenas, Honorable Senator Presidente Respicio, Senator Vice Speaker, Speaker Judy Wompat, Vice Speaker Cruz, and our brand new Senator Underwood. For the record, my name is Hope Alvarez Cristobal. I am a mother of five and grandmother of five. I am a farmer, a retired educator, a former adjunct professor of Guam history, and a former senator. I have enjoyed many career paths within our community, from village babysitter to cashier, secretary, teacher, principal, board director, and elected positions. To me, the most noble is the profession of educating people young and old. The idea is that you try to educate as many people as possible or facilitate access to as much education as possible. This guiding principle emanates from a sense of and the search for equality. Mr. Chairman, I come to this legislature once again with a heavy heart, having witnessed the passage of the demolition bill by the legislature last week, perhaps because of the resolve of a sole stakeholder, the governor of Guam, represented, of course, by his political appointees, and at first by a not so sure I want to stick my neck out there historic preservation officer, but one who eventually supported demolishing, therefore erasing the associated history of such a historically significant building as the Governor Manuel F.L. Guerrero Building in lieu of some monument or plaque. Then there is Guam State Historic Preservation Officer, whose dissenting view on preservation of this most significant historical building of the underrepresented era from 1950 to 1970, who, based on her own architectural assessment of the Governor Manuel F.L. Guerrero Building, ignored historical evidence provided at the recent public hearings without even indicating an interest in conducting a perfunctory investigation normally performed for such a building in crisis, respecting her primary mandate, not for demolishing historical tangible evidence of history, but for preservation. Mr. Chairman, I am not convinced about the current plans to demolish the Governor Manuel F.L. Guerrero building so that the Spanish colonization era can be the main focus of this area of Fagatnya. And so I am here this morning to testify in support of Bill 8633 LS, an act to place the Governor Manuel F.L. Guerrero building in the Guam Register of Historic Places. I am hopeful once again that the Governor Manuel F.L. Guerrero building will have a place of honor in the Guam Register of Historic Places and will be accorded the kind of preservation attention that it deserves. Government buildings in Hagatna hold evidence of our people's and our leaders' past achievements and actions. The Governor Manuel F.L. Guerrero building is an essential triangulation point, a base point, if you will, that includes the judiciary and the legislative building, where one can effectively take the measure of the spatial organization of the progression of Government of Guam's initial development in the period 1950 to 1970. A wealth of information can be yielded with just these three buildings representing the three branches of our local government. You can imagine all the people that contributed to the growth and development of an emergent Government of Guam. Many of our people are still alive today, and the honor is theirs for having contributed to our political growth in this period. It may simply be that they were construction workers, or that their contribution has to do with the intrinsic value of the building representing that era, the type of building materials and techniques or different standards that may offer lessons for us today. They may have been on career paths within the building that made them successful, or other such life milestones. In the book, The Death and Life of Great American Cities, the author Jane Jacobs asserts that the destruction of old buildings hurts communities and local economies by creating unnatural urban spaces. She also discussed economic advantages that certain types of businesses have when located in old buildings, asserting that new idea businesses like bookstores, ethnic restaurants, antique stores, small startups thrive in old buildings. As a matter of fact, old buildings attract people. This suggestion could possibly come from the warmth of the materials, that old cement, or the resonance of other people and historic activities that make them more interesting, something to talk about. Apparently, restoration work is good for the economy. Cultural and heritage tourism is a rapidly growing industry, and restoration brings more jobs and dollars to the local economy. Restoring a building is more labor intensive than its new construction, and also demands more skilled labor, thus resulting in higher wages. More materials and services are purchased locally, further increasing the economic impact. The author Donovan D. Ripkina, in his book, The Economics of Historic Preservation, A Community Leader's Guide, wrote for preservationists faced with convincing government officials that preservation strategies can make good economic sense. He described how preservation work helped communities make cost-effective use of resources, create jobs, revive downtowns, build tourism, and attract new businesses and workers, and more. New ideas gravitate to old buildings, attractive the creative class. A mixed-use building can be economically more stable than a newly constructed single-use building. Property values remain stable or rise in historic districts. The cost of demolition of the Governor Manuel Guerrero building of $600,000 must be factored in the cost of the new buildings. And this old building can provide inexpensive incubator space for small businesses, nonprofit organizations, startup companies, and bootstrap entrepreneurs. Its central location allows tenants and users access to banks, close by to the museum, to the Guam Congress building, the judiciary building, to small restaurants, food trucks with which users may have to interact. This old building, once preserved and restored, might just be the building that can make a difference in Hagatna's economy. While I don't particularly care for Donald Trump himself, he once said, we've all heard the expression, quote, it's cheaper to build new than it is to reconstruct, unquote. He says, that's not true. I've always found it cheaper to use an existing structure. It appears that while demolition may only be profitable to that one contractor who will demolish, preservation work in respect for antiquity and our political heritage will benefit the entire community. The three buildings, the Governor Manuel F.L. Guerrero Building, representing the executive branch, the Guam Congress Building, representing the legislative branch, and the latter judiciary building, representing the judicial branch, comprise our island's early political development history stock. This set of buildings must be recognized as a unit, and all must be listed, not one without the other, in the Guam Register of Historic Places. When residents see these three historic buildings restored, they witness Guam's history and get a sense of place, a sense of permanency, and a sense of pride. Preservation encourages community by connecting people to their shared heritage, by connecting them to their neighbors, and by encouraging public participation. Regret goes only one way. I believe this. Once you demolish the Governor Manuel F.L. Guerrero Building, it is gone, and that piece of history is destroyed, lost forever. I respectfully disagree with Mr. Joe Kinata, the historic preservation officer. No plaque or monument could ever replace the wealth of history found in that building, something so valuable in the education and the development of our people as we move towards a decolonized history. And this history, my dear senators, is ever so important in building political dignity and the national pride of our people. Rather than traveling far away to study the history of other places and other people, we can create a platform to study our own so we can write our own history, something we have not even considered doing. We must learn to love our own people and be proud of our own history. And having said all this, I by all means do not propose that progress should stop or that modernization should be discouraged. In no way does history hinder progress. In fact, it is the opposite. Because by studying and learning more about our history, we can better understand about the island we live in, and we can better prepare to modernize in the best way possible. This helps us to build a better future for ourselves. In my opinion, the Governor Manuel F.L. Guerrero Building can be preserved in tandem with the governor's plans for the restoration of the Palacio. I ask, Mr. Chairman, please report this bill out from your committee so that we can begin the work of preservation of this building when it is passed as law. Sidus Maasi, Chairman Respicio, all members of the committee, Dunkluna Sidus Maasi. At this point, I would like to include a copy of my testimony on March 4, 2015, against the demolition of the Governor Manuel F.L. Guerrero Building as part of my testimony today. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Senator Stoble. Senator Duenas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Vice Speaker Cruz, Senator Underwood, Madam Speaker. I'd like to, first of all, I'm Chris Duenas, and my position with the governor's office is as his external affairs special assistant. From the governor's office perspective, the governor himself, of course, we stand in objection to this bill for two major reasons. One is we believe that the introduction of legislation such as this really usurps the fundamental responsibility to those organizations entrusted with the duty who have shown up here, Mr. Chairman, on no less than three occasions, respectfully presenting their views on the history and what should happen with the current Manuel F. Guerrero building. Mr. Chairman, I'm concerned because while I greatly respect the testimony provided by those in favor of this legislation, and while I greatly respect those who have appeared during the hearings on Bill 32, which passed this legislature, there has been consistently an overtone that there has been absolutely nothing done with regard to the evaluation of the history and the historic value of the Monroe F.L. Guerrero building. I think that is an affront to those who have done the work, as opposed to those who have not done any work. In his testimony, Mike McKeel, member of the Board of Agatnia Restoration Authority, says, the Department of Administration has been studied and discussed for many years from the planning perspective, the overall sense of the building, that it was laid out and built in a manner that turns its back and blocks views to the Plaza de España, which many feel is one of the most important historical properties on two sides. I will not belabor the committee because you have a copy of this in your records, Mr. Chairman, but the good member, Mike McKeel, disputes very eloquently any discussion that there has simply been nothing done, even in light of the current neglect of the building for decades. There are and there have been people charged with the responsibility of capturing history who have done their due diligence. We have representatives today that can back that statement up, besides what Mr. McKeel has presented, Mr. Chairman. I say that with a degree of passion because there are other comments that have been made, Mr. Chairman, and I will take one other excerpt from Mr. McKeel's testimony. There are many better examples of recent history architecture that are being pursued for registration. So I want to also make sure that our public out there that's listening understands this organization, simply because it's the viewpoint of some that the Manuel F. Guerrero building should be acted upon in this manner, and this bill to usurp that process, to order and to say shall do. I say that because I want to make sure that people understand that these people are very dedicated to their work and are doing their due diligence. Mr. Chairman, with discussion on other properties within Agatnia, and I am a family to property owners here in Agatnia. We are private property owners. As long as it fits within the guidelines of public works and all the other regulatory agencies, it is ours to do with which the highest and best use is of the property. In numerous occasions, Mr. Chairman, there has been made mention that properties that historical preservation has conducted evaluations on, nothing's moving forward. Mr. Chairman, I would beg your indulgence that when the government is involved in its fiduciary responsibilities, the government has to act on behalf of the government. We cannot mandate what private landowners do. And I think I'm tired of saying apples because we live on Guam. I don't think it's a mangoes to mangoes comparison. Mr. Chairman, I would like to say that the governor wanted to make clear that in every presentation we've come down here in front of the committee, we have been respectful. We have not scoffed at anyone. We have presented a position that's simply different. We have agreed with those that are charged with capturing history in a methodology that doesn't always mean preservation of brick and mortar. You yourself, Mr. Chairman, had made sure numerous amendments within Bill 32 that would be clear. In perpetuity and in the present state in terms of what should be done with the area after the bill had successfully passed to demolish the building. Once again, Mr. Chairman, I don't think that I can overstate how proud the governor is of his confirmed appointees by this body. The governor takes issue with any representation that he has marshaled the resources of these very dedicated public servants and ordered them forward, damn the torpedoes, full speed ahead. Nothing could be different from the truth, Mr. Chairman. As a matter of fact, Mr. Chairman, the governor did not hatch this idea. It was based on presentations from historic preservation, from Hagatnya redevelopment, and on that deliberation and contemplation, had meetings with members of this legislature and moved forward collaboratively to introduce the legislation for the demolition. We have, I don't think you can ever say that we don't have the same passion that the advocates have for the preservation of this building. But I will say on the record two things. The governor unequivocally have not ordered anybody to do anything. And he respects with a very high degree the integrity of every single member, to include Mike McKeel and others that have come forward to make the presentation, that while the historical significance of events and political seats of government is valuable, that current brick and mortar does not represent the historical value to be preserved. I would close, Mr. Chairman, to basically say that the work beyond the demolition portion of what is being proposed, albeit concepts, yes, that's true, albeit from a company that seems to have been maligned, but if you look at the records at GITA, they were the only responder to the RFP. That the current concepts that have been put forward are a product and a body of work, once again, of dedicated public servants after having at least two meetings with regulatory agencies. And that is on the record, Mr. Chairman. Those are the same tomorrows of which we speak. They are the public servants of today. And they have made those recommendations, Mr. Chairman, although albeit concepts. Many in the media have said that's the problem. There's not enough of a sell on what's going to go forward. Everything is a process, Mr. Chairman. That would be rushing it to come out and say, here's the plan. We're going to build this. That's why we need to demolish this. No. And Mr. Vice Speaker, I thank you. And I believe Matrix, from the bottom of their heart, thanks you for letting them know that they must go out and secure additional testimony from the people of Hagatnya in order to make a plan go forward that is of value and represents the people. There's no question about that. You are right. But to place that in the same category with the testimony on this project is, albeit fair and the right thing to do, and I believe they're going to take your advice to the hilt. Once again, as the only responder to the RFP, I think they're trying to be culturally competent. I'm not their promoter, but thank God somebody responded to the RFP, because Hagatnya Restoration's got a job to do. So, Mr. Chairman, we respectfully appear to say that, once again, we are not in support of this legislation. We thank the legislature for passing the recent Bill 32, and we ask you to join us in respectfully moving forward with all the representations of the SHPO and all the agencies that have jurisdiction over these matters, that we respect their presentations and move forward on restoring Agana. Sus masi, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, sus masi. Thank you, Senator Duenas. Mr. Joaquin Paris.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Honorable Chairman Respicio, Senators, Vice Speaker Cruz. My name is Kim Paris. Most of you, the two of you, know me because we're personal friends, and Rory's my nephew. Or in the context of our individual political beliefs, whether they be consonant or divergent. I was born on Guam 69 years ago, and I will be buried here. When? Who knows? I've been a lifelong resident of the village of Santa Rita, and I am retired. And though I may occasionally comment on certain issues, for the most part, every day is Saturday for me. So it's strange that I'm down here on a Tuesday. Today, I am submitting this testimony out of concern over the proposal to demolish, or the demolition, of the Governor Manuel F. L. Guerrero administration building, and in support of the immediate passage and enactment of subsequent legislation, namely Bill Number 86-33, relative to the placement of this building on the Guam Historic Preservation Registry. The comment was made that the legislature should not go in and contradict what boards and commissions do, or the work that they're supposed to circumvent, if you will, the work that they're supposed to do. I call your attention to the fact that it's been done several times, because this legislature has to make a decision sometimes where a body out there just makes a decision strictly on technical aspects. This legislature has to take more than the technical aspects into concern. Personally, I strongly object to the demolition of what I believe is an important landmark. Perhaps not important for those in the tourism industry, whose primary objectives are to encourage an ever-increasing number of visitors to this island, or even for the younger generation who never had the chance to experience the activities that took place in those offices and hallways. To me, the Guerrero administration building, which housed the office of the governor, is symbolic of initial efforts to establish an effective form of governance and to reestablish its Chamorro identity and revitalize the real meaning of Chamorro. Simply put, just this reasoning should be justification for placing that building on the registry of important places and structures deserving protection and preservation. With the appointment of Governor Joseph Flores as the first Chamorro governor of Guam, and the subsequent appointment of Manuel F. L. Guerrero, another Chamorro, political thought began to focus and point to the need to continue and indeed to intensify the quest to determine for ourselves the future political relationship of this island, not only with the United States, but with every other sovereign nation of the world. Guam's tenuous political alliance may ostensibly be 10,000 miles to the east on the banks of the Potomac River. However, I believe our realities must be governed by coexistence and collaboration with our brothers in the Pacific and the sovereign nations to our west. This thought is not always in consonance with the thinking along the Potomac. I believe that the rehabilitation of the Manuel F. L. Guerrero building and the return of the office of the governor to that building can and will provide the basis for the reestablishment, growth, and excitement for a vibrant and true Chamorro identity, something obliterated by 500 years of military and religious colonization by the Spanish conquistadors, 52 years of subjugation by a U.S. military establishment totally indifferent to the real needs of our people, and 117 years of constitutional colonialism by an indolent and lethargic federal establishment, which primarily listens to that indifferent military establishment hell-bent on protecting, first and foremost, their motherland, which, Mr. Chairman, does not include this insignificant dot in the vast Pacific we call Guam. To this military establishment, and indeed to the majority of the federal establishment, including Congress, Guam is a territorial possession, a small piece of real estate whose only value is military in nature. Unfortunately, contrary to the founding precepts of America, the people residing on this territorial possession are also treated as possessions. In other words, slaves. To those who experienced working with Governor Manuel Guerrero and eventually Carlos Camacho, Ricky Bordalho, and Paul Calvo in that building, the building is not only filled with good memories, but at that time with an awful lot of hope that this community would grow and mature politically, economically, and socially. And then through a deliberate act of self-determination, the original people of Guam and their descendants will choose for themselves the island's ultimate political status and future. I understand the desire of each member of this legislature to participate in and promote the beautification of this island. Hopefully, first to improve the quality of life for our people, and secondly, in the hopes that it will draw more off-island visitors here to enjoy Guam's beauty and hospitality, and eventually to spend a lot of their money. What I do not understand is why is there such a rush? We know that improving the quality of life for our people deserves much thought and deliberation, and our people will accept changes to that quality of life at a pace they will establish for themselves, not at a pace established by others, whether in government or not, or in a rush to judgment. So it seems that the real motivation behind this rush to raise the Guerrero building is a desire to boost the visitor industry, the quest for that magical 2 million visitor mark, by giving deference to the aesthetics of the area over the historical importance of its structures. We pursue what we think will be pleasing to the eyes of the tourists, giving such preference over the historical significance and importance of the structure and what transpired over time. And we really don't know if reaching that goal of 2 million visitors will be good for the real people of this island. The magic of 2 million visitors is the dream child of those in the visitor industry and those who think that it will lead to that mythical pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. A very knowledgeable Guam businessman and Guam educators have noted that no true study or analysis has ever been commissioned or performed to determine whether 2 million visitors will be good for this island. This businessman and those educators are true Guam stakeholders, not carpetbaggers just looking for a quick buck. Without intending any disrespect, and then lately it seemed that everyone in government is in a rush to spend newfound money, the revaluation of Guam's real estate tax rolls has increased the government's borrowing capacity by $3 million or more, $300 million or more. So now it seems that everybody is in a rush to find projects on which to spend that windfall. Guida is chomping at the bits to be able to promote and manage such a borrowing, as their management fees and commissions will also be considerable. To some, Guida's motivation at encouraging continuous and additional debt is merely to ensure its self-perpetuation. Likewise, there are off-island consultants, which I refer to as carpetbaggers because they are, also chomping at the bits for their turn at the feeding trough, or in the vernacular, at the tepe baboy. Lately, it seems that the one project receiving the most attention in this regard is the revitalization of Agatnya. And some want it to appear that this project, actually the brainchild of Mr. Jesus Leon Guerrero, founder of the Bank of Guam, is dependent on the demolition of the first real central office of the government of Guam. A lot of people are jumping on this bandwagon. From Adelup to these hallowed halls, to the dizzying heights of Guida's offices on the fourth floor of the ITC building, and to the intoxicating sea air of Ipaw and the GBB offices. And to emphasize the immediate need for the Hagatnya facelift, there are those who propose that demolishing the Guerrero building is necessary for the success of 2016 Festival of the Pacific. However, as I remember it from its inception, the revitalization of Hagatnya did not include the destruction of the Guerrero building, nor did it call for the demolition of the Hagatnya police precinct, nor was there any mention that the Festival of the Pacific would be centered in Agatnya. But then again, I also don't think that Tony Suos thought that the obliteration of Skinner Plaza would be a necessary component of a revitalized capital. Tony Suos envisioned a capital where visitors and residents alike would enjoy walking through the seat of government and the repository of history throughout the day. Agatnya, as it now stands, is a ghost town after the sun sets, except perhaps for the Wednesday night markets at Isingson Samoro. I think it is safe to say that all of us, every citizen of Guam, wants to see a revitalization of the island's capital. I just don't know that this mad rush to pave the way for future construction and beautification at the expense of destroying a very real part of our history is the right way to proceed. It is my hope that the carpetbaggers still waiting at the tapir can and will be forced to produce some real plans, including acceptable cost estimates for every phase of the revitalization. It is my hope that more deliberate patience will be exercised in arriving at that irreversible decision. If my memory serves me right, the consultants being used for the Hagatne redevelopment project are the same consultants paid millions to produce Guam's first response to the proposed military buildup in 2006 and 2007. And I think at that time they were also the only responders to the RFP. A response that wasn't worth the paper it was written on, for which we've still paid millions for useless reams of colorful nothing. The need for patience and deliberate restraint can be gleaned from other projects of similar nature. In 1988, the dangers of continued uses of the old Island Court Guam Congress building as the official home of the Guam legislature became very apparent. The building and all of its additions were literally falling apart. Plans were developed at considerable cost to rehabilitate the structure with additional office spaces. At that time, the legislature was composed of 21 senators and their staff, and I think it should go back to that. And it was not difficult to envision a structure to house all of that activity. The vision of the primary structure itself, the Island Court Guam Congress building, would be to house the office of the speaker, the session hall, and the public hearings rooms, as well as some of central office. Later on, there would be revisions to these plans. Needless to say, the project never got off the ground. And only recently have plans been approved, the funding identified, and soon between the collaborative efforts of the legislature and the Guam Preservation Trust, the work on rehabilitating that historic building and improving it to house the Guam legislature will begin and become a reality. If my math or chronology is not mistaken, that project began over 20 years ago, and the final go-ahead had been approved only this year. Early in 1990, the legal counsel of the Jose Luhan family met with Senator Francisco Arsanto to inform him that the Luhan had been approached by a developer offering to purchase the Luhan property in Hagatne. That property included the structure used at the Guam Normal School. Some of Guam's premier minds received an early education in the Guam Normal School. The alumni list is impressive. Without hesitation, Senator Santos ordered a legislative proposal to exchange Guam property for those two substandard lots. Government funding was tenuous at best, and the Luhan family were willing to accept a land exchange. Over 10 acres of land were exchanged for two substandard lots. The two sides of the equation may be lopsided, but history is preserved and protected. The Luhan House itself was in a sad state of disrepair. I walked through the building. The building was not safe to enter and was boarded up. A small modular house next to the structure had to be vacated. The tenants were evicted, and the structure eventually demolished. It took over 10 years for the government to finally decide to rehabilitate that building. And that rehabilitation, in my research, cost around $1 million. I'm beginning to believe that what Vice Speaker Cruz said of over $3 million is probably correct. For a structure that is only 1,100 square feet in size, today everyone is proud of the Luhan House. It is a showcase of Agatna. It houses the office of the Guam Preservation Trust, and I pity the people who tried to remove the trust from that building. I might also point out that the consultants used for the Luhan House project and the consultant that will be used for the Guam Congress Building project and eventually the Palacios project are all locally based, locally owned stakeholders. The Guam Preservation Trust recently purchased another pre-war home in Agatna, and it will be rehabilitated and rebuilt. Again, that will take time and a lot of intense discussion and study and a detailed review of the funding requirements before anything is done. In 2005, the Ladder of Freedom Foundation began deliberations on whether to attempt to build a scaled-down version of the Ladder of Freedom envisioned by Governor Ricky Berdalio. Much thought was given as to where such a project would best be located. Finally, a decision was reached to begin discussions with then-Governor Felix Camacho. Macho, to permit the building of a Ladder of Freedom next to the structure built atop Adams Point. The first reaction of the governor's office was a flat-out no. They believed that the structure at Adelou was damaged by the 1991 earthquake, subsequent smaller tremors, and super typhoons Paka and Bongsonwa. The Department of Public Works at the time was prepared to condemn the structure, and the governor's office was prepared to call for its demolition. Not only the structure on top, but the entire school, entire Adelou, where the governor's office is now. One of the advantages of being a member of Congress, your ability to call upon federal agencies for assistance. In this case, Congressman Medaglio requested for a second opinion on the condition of the structure from the Army Corps of Engineers. An engineering evaluation was conducted. The Army Corps analysis simply noted that the structure was sound and safe, that there were no structural damages or dangers. I'm not sure that this has been done with the Guerrero building. With this evaluation, immediate discussion and studies were initiated to begin the rehabilitation and renovation of the existing structure into what is now called the Hall of Governors. An architectural and engineering plans were developed, including soil borings, to determine whether the point could sustain a structure the size and weight of the planned lattice. All this was done by local firms. No off-island firms were even invited to participate. When the bid package was finished, reviewed, and approved by the foundation, the bid was announced, and five local construction companies submitted proposals. A local construction firm was hired. A local A&E firm was hired to manage the construction, and within 3 years, the ribbon cutting was performed, all at a cost of around $2 million. I think I know a little bit about the Ladder of Freedom, that structure down there. Today we look at the Guerrero building and the first thought is to demolish the structure simply because it's ugly and in a sad state of disrepair. We here estimate that it would cost $17 to $25 million to rehab and renovate the structure, yet no one can produce detailed engineering analyses or reliable cost estimates that are signed off by an engineering firm licensed to business on Guam and who has a stake in making sure that the numbers and estimates are as accurate as possible. The Guam Preservation Trust has been in discussion with A&E firms on the rehabilitation and rebuilding of the Palazzo. A lot of time has been spent on this project, which is now on hold for various reasons. With so many people wanting to get involved in these projects, why the need for so much rush? The GPT has proven that there are capable A&E and consulting firms on island. Why the rush and the need to hire carpetbaggers? Particularly carpetbaggers whose previous performances raise serious questions. In the end, if it is deemed necessary to demolish the Manuel Guerrero building, then perhaps it would be good if everything between Salon Santo Papa and O'Brien Drive, from the plaza side of the Basilica to the federal detention facility, be demolished, including the bandstand, chocolate house, the old museum, the old Spanish wall. Everything should be demolished so that we can begin with a new palette. Have a lot of open space. I have nothing against the rebuilding of the Palazzo and its adjacent grounds. I worked with the Palace Restoration Foundation from 1994 to 2004. In 2004, I closed out its bank account and delivered a large cashier's check to Government House for rebuilding the mini museum in the Guma Tototono. It was thought at that time that the money would have been put to better use. Senators, I have real issues with the demolition of the structure where our quest for real self-governance and its moral identity began. For the sake of showcasing a symbol of Spanish colonialism, the Spanish attempt to decimate the Zamora race and the continuation of that decimation by subsequent colonizers who tried to kill our language by prohibiting its uses in public and who have since 1898 continued to treat our people as mere possessions. If we're going to rebuild the Spanish Palazzo, then let it be in the shadows of the building, which represents the beginning of our quest to reestablish the Zamora identity, our quest for full self-governance, and our quest to realize our inalienable rights to self-determination. To do less would raise questions on the meaning, personal commitment to, and the spirit of Inafresi, a pledge each of us takes at the beginning of every official these halls. So before we rush to destroy a real part of Agatna, I ask that this body let the Guam Historic Preservation Board do its job. Review the history of the building, review the historic events which occurred within the walls, and review the significance of the building, its events and players in the greater scheme and quest for self-governance, its Samoro identity and Samoro self-determination. Through the lessons we learned with the Island Court, Guam Congress Building, with the Luhan House, Guam Normal School property, with the Hall of Governors and the Ladder of Freedom, let us take the time to really study this matter, to study its history, and to demand more detailed discussions, greater and more detailed plans and estimates. What's the rush? Thank you for permitting me to vent.
Thank you very much for your testimony as well, Mr. Cameron.
Half a day, honorable senators. My name is Joseph Artero Cameron. I come to you today as the Executive Director for Hagatnya Restoration and Redevelopment Authority. Unfortunately, we are unable to provide a complete testimony regarding Bill 8633, as it is the Board of Commissioners' policy to seek board approval prior to testimony submittals. The HRA has a diverse membership, representatives from the administration, the Guam Legislature, and the Hagatnya community under the leadership of the Mayor of Hagatnya and the Governor of Guam. Mr. John Cavo's chairman has stated that it has been in his experience that each AR Board of Commissioners has one thing in common, a strong passion to revitalize, restore, and redevelop our capital city of Hagatnya. There are many layers of history in the area we fondly refer to as the Plaza de España. We have all seen pictures and heard the stories from Armanomko, the May fairs, the parades, the first baseball game held in Guam, the Carabao races held around the plaza, the processions, the band playing in the kiosco, the Spanish and American surrender of Guam in the plaza, the Pope's visit to our part of the world, the governor's inaugurations, the many weddings, baptismal, and family events held in and around the Plaza de España. Every layer is certainly worth remembering. Each layer has a different meaning to each of us. We are not here to downplay the historical importance of the former DOA building. There are certainly historical occurrences in the 48 years past of this building. The question is, which layer do we memorialize? To what degree? And how do we record that history for our posterity? Do we fully restore the Plaza de España, or do we fully restore the old DOA building to a fully functional Government of Guam facility, ? Will we be able to bring the requisite Government of Guam agencies back to our city center, ? Will we be able to bring the requisite Government of Guam agencies back to our center should the registration of historical sites be legislated or vetted through an established statutory process, ? According to the State Historic Preservation Office and also the Guam Preservation Trust, there's already an established legal process and protocol to register and protect historic sites and objects. A legislative bill such as Bill 8633 should not be in that legal process that circumvents already accepted and vetted established legal procedures. There are ways to record our history in books, both history and biographies in our school classes, and in the Guam and Chamorro Educational Facility, to name a few, known as the Guam Museum. should point out that we cannot testify on behalf of the HRA since the HRA has yet to meet to discuss this bill. As we did for bill number 3233, the board of directors voted in favor of the demolition of the D-Way building. Although we can reiterate our position, HRA supports the demolition of the old D-Way building. The Hagania Restoration and Redevelopment Authority will schedule a meeting as soon as possible to discuss and recommend the HRA's position on Bill 8633, as ultimately the Board of Commissioners and this esteemed body will decide on the plan as a whole. It is imperative that we arrive at a consensus. In the end, it is both our goal to implement a plan for the greater good of the people of Guam. Sidzus Mamsi.
Thank you also, Mr. Cameron. Senators, do you have any follow-up questions for the panel? But I want to thank the four of you for your participation this morning. We do have some other individuals who signed up to testify in this bill. Thank you. And all of your testimonies will be transcribed and put into the committee report. The other individual, Joseph Santos, is no longer here, right? The other individual who signed up to testify is Kelly Marsh. Recognize at this time to present your Mr. Santos, will you, are you going to provide testimony as well? Okay, so your testimony is consistent with HRA. It's yes. Part of it. Okay.
As mentioned, my name is Kelly Marsh. And I offer this testimony on behalf of the preservation and protection of the Manuel F. L. Guerrero building referred to in the legislation being considered today. In so doing, I ask us to consider the following. As the tourists and school children of Guam walk through Hagatnya by the thousands every year, they read our history and the landscape through the structures and buildings that remain. From the thousands of years of ancestral connection to the land represented by the Ladi at the Senator Angel L. G. Santos Memorial Park, to the hundreds of years of colonialism that the Plaza de España represents, to the final linchpin in the people of Guam's quest for civil rights and self-government with the Guam Walkout of 1949, embodied by the old Guam Congress/Legislature building. And in this historic landscape, the Manuel F. Leon Guerrero building also tells its own part of our story. The time period in which it was constructed, which is visibly recognizable, brings us back to that period of time, the 50s and the 60s, a time of social and political transformation throughout the United States, including Guam, when the civilian government of Guam was forged. It was, in a sense, the crucible in which was formed the public institutions of our modern democratic elected government, where the people of Guam themselves finally served, not as clerks and other support staff, but as department directors and chief executives, and ultimately as the elected, not appointed, chief executive of the government of Guam, the governor. What will we tell our children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren if that part of our story is no longer present for them to be able to read in the landscape, for them to be able to understand in a way that can only be understood and felt by experiencing it firsthand? Will we have to tell them that the physical embodiment of all of those decades of struggle by our grandparents and our great-grandparents to be heard, to be counted, to participate in their own government was not important enough for us to come together as a community and roll up our sleeves to work at preserving and protecting that precious, irreplaceable part of our people's story? So with that, I thank you for your attention and for providing the opportunity for me to provide testimonies. Sidzus Mamsi.
Okay. This bill has been publicly heard and will continue to stay in contact regarding this matter. The next item on the agenda is a status update on the tree ordinance by the Department of Agriculture's Forestry and Soil Resources Division. We'll just continue in this setup instead of doing round, you know, square table. Roland Kitagua, Joseph Santos, you. Jose San Nicolas. Mr. Kitagua, can you just bring your group up? I know GPA is a strong partner in this effort. So if I could, I mean, we had an additional table and some additional chairs. I want everybody to be included, but more specifically, I want everybody to be recognized. Okay, good morning, everyone. Now that we've regrouped, I want to say that I wanted to have a status update on the tree ordinance. That's a strong partnership between the Department of Agriculture's Forestry and Soil Resources Division, and I wanted to give these individuals an opportunity to not only present to the legislature, specifically to this committee, but also to the public by way of having this broadcast just live on our legislative channel. This project is extremely significant because, as you know, the Guam Power Authority does a lot of tree trimming, and the Department of Agriculture together, including GPA especially, they want to make sure that there's some not rules and regs, but some standards and a policy in place by legislation so that there will be consistency in how these trees are trimmed. And so before just introducing the bill, I wanted to bring this out by way of a public discussion. We can formulate our thoughts and our ideas together, put it in a bill form, and then if it's ready to go, we can introduce it that way. But I'm excited about this opportunity, and I know you've been thinking about this for quite some time. You've been meeting for quite some time, and you're just at the almost real close to putting everything together. And you do have a PowerPoint presentation, but I want to give you an opportunity to take the lead here, Mr. Kitagua, or whomever you want to designate to give some opening statements, and I'll have everybody introduce themselves. Well, you were the first one who signed up in.
Is that what happens when you show up early?
Yeah, in no particular order of importance. It's just order
actually,
of.
For the record, sir, let's just say that Department of Agriculture Division of Forestry is actually taking the lead on this.
I know that, but that's why I said in no particular order of importance. Okay. Mr. Santos, who would like to?
Actually, probably an appropriate person would be Joe Mongus.
Yeah, Joe, Mr. Mongus, but I was okay.
I'm sorry, Senator. I did not get a chance to sign in earlier, so that's why my signature's not there.
Okay.
So thank you. My name is Joe Mongus. I'm the chief of the Forestry Division, Department of Agriculture, and Senator Respicio, Mr. Chair, and Senator Underwood, thank you very much for allowing us to come today to discuss this tree ordinance regulation, I guess, or guidelines. So anyways, I just want to recognize our newly appointed Deputy Director, Mr. Jess Pelican, second day in his job today. So, you know, he's here to provide support or show his support and really just learn what it is that we're trying to do. I've been trying to spin him up in the last half hour on what it is that we're trying to do. So,
Mayor, congratulations on your appointment.
Okay, so I guess that being said,
let's go down the line. I want everybody to introduce themselves, and then I'll have you, Chief, give your PowerPoint.
I'm Roland Kilgore with the University of Guam Cooperative Extension Service. I'm also with the Northern Soil and Water Conservation District, who acts as a technical advisor for the Department of Agriculture.
Morning, Senators. My name is Jesse Pelican, the Deputy Director for Agriculture on the second day, and I'm here also to represent our director. I'm sorry he can't be here today because he had another urgent appointment today.
My name is Joseph Santos. I'm a planner, senior planner with the Haganya Restoration and Redevelopment Authority, but I'm also here under the Northern Guam Soil Water Conservation District.
Today, my name is Justin Santos. I'm a forester with the Department of Agriculture. I am the Urban and Community Forestry Program Manager, and I was the one that initiated this working group.
I'm Vinicio Roma from GPA, overhead superintendent. Basically, my responsibility is all that vegetation out there for our company.
And it's important to note for the record that GPA is in full support of this initiative and actually you're a strong partner in this effort. Yeah. Because usually the autonomous agencies don't want to be regulated in any way, shape, or form. But in this case, this is something that you you stand by and you're participating in.
Okay. All right, thank you, Senator. I guess we'll just get into the presentation. I know everybody's busy, so again, it's just an informational brief status update. So I just wanted to go to, just so for your information, you know, what it is that we do at the Forestry Division, that way you get a better understanding of, you know, why it is that we're doing, you know, what we're doing today. So our mandate and our mission here in forestry is to protect and enhance our forest and soil resources. So that covers a lot of things, you know, not only in the rural landscape, but also in the urban landscape. That addresses everything from reforestation work to urban forestry to forest health, invasive species, and private landowner conservation forestry work that they do. And we do that, we accomplish that with four core programs, our forest stewardship programs, forest health, urban and community, and cooperative fire. That addresses wildland fire issues. And that's in partnership with the Guam Fire Department. If you have any questions, Senators, please just go ahead and ask as we go. Okay, in partnership with the U.S. Forest Service, they are our federal counterpart. They provide federal funding to our programs. So they're a big supporter of what it is that we're trying to do today and trying to implement this tree ordinance. So at the national level, they've identified three themes there. Conserve working lands, protect forest from harm, protect and enhance public benefits from trees. So I wanted to highlight the third bullet point there as far as what their objectives to meet that one national theme there. It's protect and enhance water quality and quantity, improve air quality, assist communities in planning and reducing wildland fire risk, maintain and enhance economic benefits and values of trees and forests, protect and conserve wildlife and fish habitat, connect people and trees to forest and engage them in environmental stewardship programs, and manage and restore trees and forests to mitigate and adapt to global climate change. And as we know, our governor has been nominated by the president to, you know, to, I guess, head the climate change committee, I guess, at the national level. So what it is that we're doing there, forestry also addresses that issue. So along those lines, the Forest Service, again, they, like I said, they're really supportive of our programs and what it is that we're trying to do. And in our discussion, in our many meetings, they've, you know, they suggested to and recommended that we implement this tree ordinance. And again, Senators, this tree ordinance has been in discussion for many years, probably as far back as the early 2000s. And I think Mr. Kiriguer can attest to that, or the former chief, the late Dave Limtiaku. They've been trying to do something like this for many years. So what we're trying to do today is not some knee-jerk reaction. This thing is a slow and a deliberate process that we've been trying to do. And, you know, we understand that creating any kind of regulation or legislation or policies that may impact the public, you know, whether it's positive or negative, we need to be very deliberate of that, especially if it's going to impact them, you know, in their pocketbooks. So we got to be—we're very mindful of that. So again, just to highlight what benefits trees are to the public, so we can again understand why it is that we're trying to do and how this thing ties in, you know, creating an ordinance, how it ties in into what it is, you know, GPA is doing and all the other utility agencies as well, and how it can benefit our community as a whole, and not only the community, but also our tourism economy. Okay, so obviously public benefits of trees, it saves energy. If you plant trees in a strategic location, obviously it shades it out, reduces your energy costs and things like that. I was in a meeting a couple years ago, and one of the schools, their energy cost was like in the six figures every month. So if we strategically place trees, you know, it could offset some of that. Again, we're not being naive to think that it's going to reduce it by half, but any savings, you know, would be very helpful, right? Improve air quality. As everybody knows, our trees are the natural filters of the, you know, the air that we breathe. So as our population grows and our demand for tourism and the buses and all the pollutants coming out of our exhaust system contaminates the air, you know, that there's more need for trees, right? So that's another public benefit. Strengthens quality of place and the local economy. If you have trees in your landscape, beautiful trees, and properly maintained trees, obviously your land value would increase. You know, people prefer that rather than just bare land. And, you know, again, really depends on your landowner requirements. But essentially, if you have nice landscape trees, it does improve the value of your property. In the urban setting, you know, especially in the parks and schools. I know that Dedadu Revitalization Parks Program, they've tried to get us engaged to try and help them or assist them in their revitalization program out there. And trees, incorporating trees in their landscape is a big part of that process. And again, it's talking about putting the right tree in the right place, and so we can minimize our costs, you know, or their costs. Reduces stormwater runoff. Again, more trees in the landscape. Trees does offset the pressures when rainfall drops. You know, it kind of disperses the impacts of those raindrops. Believe it or not, as tiny as those raindrops are, trees do offset the impacts of the water that's coming down. Reduces pollution as well. Improves social connection. When we go to parks, you know, when we see a nice landscape area, obviously it brings some intrinsic value, right? We're more at peace, we're more calm. It just reduces our stress, right? So when we go out there to do a smoke break, we go under the tree. That's the first thing you do. You don't go out in the hot sun. Helps promote smart growth. Again, proper planning in the urban setting, you know, provide green space in the urban setting. It just creates that at peace with people. Walkable communities, and walking in the parks. We got a lot of hiking trails, a lot of tracks, running tracks. You know, we have these trees and these landscapes. You know, it just brings people out. They're more inclined to come out and engage in that type of activity, increasing their health, obviously. Okay, so those are essentially the benefits of trees. Okay, now I'm pretty sure other people have more opinions about that, but that's pretty much what, you know, what we can come up with. Now, so this is where we're at, post-tree ordinance. Obviously, and further down on the presentation, you're going to see some pictures of trees and improper pruning of trees and things like that. So, So that's the reason why we needed to do something like this, or we're proposing to do something like this. Again, it's really for your consideration. If you think that it does make sense to do something like this, then that'll be great. So in Title V GCA, under the forestry section there, it mandates us, or it's required that any tree cutting in government properties, just on government properties now, requires a tree cutting permit. With the exception of the Lucena, the Tangentongan, you know, if you can cut it regardless. Now, the problem with that GCA, or that title, that section of the GCA, is that there are no standards. It just says you need to get a tree cutting permit from the Department of Agriculture, and the director would determine if, you know, the health and vigor of that tree, and if it makes sense to cut it, then they can do so.
Sorry, is that being done now?
Yes.
Your department issues permits?
Yes, we do. Mr. Santos, he does the site inspection along with whoever's going to do the tree cutting, makes the recommendation, and then I sign off on that permit. Now, again...
Because I'm just preparing all of us for your next slide.
Okay.
And so if you're issuing permits now,
yes.
I want to know how is it that we're going to be shown slides of how trees are currently
right.
Cut.
Yeah. And, you know, again, everything, you know, there's always good and bad and everything, right?
Yeah,
and we need to see what kind of opportunities that can come out of that. Right. So anyways, it requires, and we do issue the permits, and we do try and educate and inform the folks that are cutting those trees, the proper way of doing it. So in 2010, or in 2008, at the federal level, they mandated all state forestry agencies in the 50 states and the territories to develop what they call the state action plan, which is what we did. And that was, we needed to submit that in 2010, which we did. And that is the basis and the foundation of any of our grant opportunities, for future. Had we not done this, created this document, we would not be able to write for any grants through the Forest Service. And the reason why I bring this thing up is because we've identified six priorities, and the one there that I wanted to highlight is the urban forest sustainability. And that ties in directly with proposed tree ordinance that we're discussing today. And there are two strategies there to address that, is work with the local and the military to avoid deforestation and develop a tree ordinance laws for new and old development. So as you can see, that's in our that 5-year plan that we've developed in 2010. And then implement tree planting and monitoring projects in developed areas, open space, and parks and communities. Again, it all ties in. So if we don't have standards to, as we move forward in the implementation of these issues and priorities, then we're going to have a continued repeat of what you're going to see in the later slides. Okay, so again, back to the U.S. Force, based on all of our discussions and all throughout the years, they did recommend that we implement a tree ordinance again. So this is in support with the U.S. Forest Service and our local stakeholders as well. So this is not something that we just sat at the table one day and said we needed a tree ordinance. This is from stakeholder input. Okay, so just to highlight the working group, obviously the Forestry Division, Guam Power, DPW, DPR, UOG, GVB, the Mayor's Council, and the Legislature. We try to get all these folks engaged, and we started this thing in the working group in 2012. And, they came up with some suggestions, and we can provide that information if you like. I don't think we have anything right now on the minutes that they worked in since 2012. So they develop a mission statement and a vision statement. And again, basically it's just to develop this guidelines to establish some standards and to promote the health and vigor of the trees in our urban landscape. And the vision statement is an island rooted in culture. There was no play on words in that vision statement there. You got to laugh around the corner. So in that working group, in all their meetings, they've identified challenges and issues and possible solutions. Okay, and just to summarize that, and obviously you can go ahead and take a look at, and if you want to ask some questions and. Okay, so challenges and issues, just to try and summarize it, improper tree cutting, wrong tree in the wrong place, impacts the infrastructure, public safety, encroachment in, you know, like in intersections and things like that. You've got trees planted and blocking the vision in traffic, lack of management, lack of education and training certification, things like that. Obviously public safety. That's the gist, you know, wrong tree in the wrong place.
Well, the wrong tree in the wrong place is another reason why GPA has an interest in this.
Yes, absolutely.
You pointed
absolutely
out the planting of coconut trees right under a power line.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
yes.
An example.
So solutions, possible solutions again. Obviously set some standards to support our mandates in the Title V. Maintenance, management, proper management of trees, training of the utility agencies, getting them the proper training and certification. And we can talk about that later. Mr. Santos can talk about that a little bit later. Enforcement of these regulations, you know, without, you know, if we create something like this and we don't have the ability to enforce these things, then it's going to be just, you know, it is going to be what it is, right? So we need to have some enforcement capabilities, whether it's civil penalties or, you know, that's up for discussion. Obviously, more efficient and permits or more efficient permit process. Train people, you know, the utility agencies, get them trained up, spun up, and as far as to how they can properly prune the trees. At least get the folks, GPA, if they're going to outsource the tree cutting contracts, at least people internally, they know and they have the knowledge, so they can go out there and they can convey that message to the contractors. Any contracts going to, whether it's through GVB, DPR, you know, we would like to see some, if we can have some input in the development of that contract, so that way we can provide that guidance. But again, if as we move forward and this thing matures, you know, maybe those utility agencies, the folks that are in there, they may be able to be so proficient at what it is that they're doing that we don't have to be part of that. Again, maybe in the initial stages, but like I said, as we mature moving forward, somebody in their respective agencies would be able to do that work. Replacement program. So if there's a need to cut a tree, the idea here is if you cut one tree, then replace it with two. Again, it's just a proposal. It's up for discussion. Possible tax break incentive programs, and maybe Roland or Justin can speak a little bit more on that. And then landmark heritage tree program. Say, for example, a good example is if we want to honor a former senator for the contribution to the natural resource arena, and we want to, say, for example, plant an aphid tree and put it down there, and then, you know, it's like a legacy type of thing. So something to put significance to that tree, to show the importance of that tree. Okay. So the committee, and this is in 2012, when they met, the working group, they identified different contracts that annual cost to the maintenance cost of trees. And bottom line, it came up to about $3 million, and that's in 2012. So that may have gone up, I'm not sure, but these are just the areas that they've identified, and that list could be double that list, I'm not sure. But this is just what when they met in on that one meeting, this is what they came up with, and that's a ballpark figure, about $3 million. So again, it's important that we highlight this, because if we do it properly, then we may, there could be a possibility of the reducing that cost. And maybe Ivan can speak on that. He might have better insight on that. So who else spends? EOG, DOC, Port Authority, all these other agencies. Again, in this process, we probably could get, you know, request the information and get more information on that end. So why is the tree ordinance needed? Again, just to reiterate, recommended by the Forest Service, stakeholder desires, improper and unauthorized tree cutting, no set standards, impacts to the tree health, it's a public safety and hazard,
on managed trees increases your maintenance costs. Properly managed trees and the right tree, the right place would reduce your maintenance costs. Okay, so that's pretty much it for that presentation. The following slides are just pictures that I've taken or we've taken in the past. So what this represents here is again, obviously wrong tree in the wrong place, right? And how it impacts the facilities and infrastructure. So that tree is a pretty significant size tree. It's gonna take maybe a staff of two, maybe two, possibly 3 days to remove this tree. And that's just cutting it, not to transport it and things like that. So now you got all you're seeing the cost associated to you know why this tree is there. This is, I think, if I'm not mistaken, just based on the area there, I think just the Plaza de España in that area. So as you can see, this tree was just hacked off, and this is I don't think it's gonna recover. And I'm not sure if this tree, I'm not sure if that tree is still there, but what I wanted to represent here is that if this tree starts to shoot its branches out again, what's gonna happen is that those branches are not gonna be structurally sound. It's gonna be weak. And then if there's a function there, people are gonna be congregating under this area. And
you know, I think that was the reason why that tree looks like that, because it was already, The branches were already weak,
right.
And as a safety measure and a precaution, those branches were.
Right.
Because you remember there was an individual that a tree limb branch
right.
fell on that person and they died.
Right.
During the parade.
Liberation, right.
Liberation parade, and so you should put a disclaimer that tree looks like that because it had to.
Yes.
It had, and I think eventually it was. I don't know if it's still up, but I think it's
right. Okay, got it.
Yeah.
That and the thing is, it's just to represent that, you know, if this is what's happening out there, not just in this one particular area, and again, really it's
yeah,
not
all
there.
Of
there
those trees around the
yeah.
cathedral
right.
needed to be trimmed because
yeah.
the branches were no longer they were no longer alive, and
yeah.
they were actually very weak, and they could have done more harm to.
Right. And that's why we want to try and get something like this, because after they do that, right now there are no standards, right? So when they cut it, and like you said, it addresses the immediate concern about the branches being weak, but then they leave it like that
yeah.
because there are no standards and there are no enforcement or follow up on this thing. So now you've got a real big tree that could really hurt somebody. And again, this is. Another example of a improper, obviously improper. Again, it's right next to school, right next to their outdoor pavilion there. And if this thing does come back again, you know, then the good thing about trees and you know, in nature, they're very resilient and they'll come back and they'll try and survive and thrive and they'll adapt. However, you know, as we continue to damage these things, you know, at some point it's going to get weak and it's not going to be structurally sound anymore, right? So. This thing is a monkey pot, if I'm not mistaken, and as you know, monkey pots can get really big. And these branches that are going to come out, maybe not next year, maybe not the following year, maybe not 5 years, but at some point in time, if the right conditions exist and their kids or anybody that are down there, these branches can fall and could hurt, really seriously injure somebody. So we're not, you know, again, this is a long-term thing, and it's out of sight, out of mind for now, but at some point it may come down. No, I'll get up. Yeah. That's correct. Yeah. Right. And it goes back again to the point, ma'am, that you know, there's no standards, and these trees are there, and they're growing, and so again, it's no fault of anybody.
Yeah.
It's just that we need to try and educate folks to try and do a more smarter landscaping process.
Have you done a island-wide assessment on all government properties and which trees are like non-conforming if you were to have the standard?
Well, not all government properties, but I know in the schools, and Mr. Sanchez, Justin.
It will make for a good project, right? To
I did an assessment with Bruce Williams, the superintendent for maintenance over there. He was supposed to come up with a master plan to present to the governor, and that master plan never came out. I did go with him to all the schools of concern, and I did assessments for him on what needed to be taken down and removed, and what maintenance needed to be done on certain trees.
If I might add, in I think it was in 2004 when we had 2003 when we had the first arborist workshop here on Guam, where we did tree worker and certified arborists and certified tree workers. What we did was we took the class out to Marshall Spawn, and we actually did structural pruning. And so what people need to understand, and one of the things that really bothers the people in the natural resources arena, is the fact that a lot of people have this idea that when you plant a tree, that's the end. When actually, when you plant a tree, it's the beginning. It's just like when you're raising it. It's like raising a child. And so while we did do crown cleaning, while we did remove branches, you know, what was that, 10 years ago, that were at risk of falling and harming children, it's something that has not been followed up. It's my professional opinion that I don't think that any of the trees needed to be removed at Marshall Spawn. I think they needed an annual program. And if you go back and you trim it annually properly, you actually reduce the amount of maintenance needed for those trees. The one of the biggest issues that we have is, and it happens every year, people act as if this is something new, but every summer we hijack employees from every Gulf Guam agency to go out and prep the schools for the next school year. And you've got everybody out there with good intentions, but without the proper knowledge and training, and end up causing more problems than they actually than good. And as this tree's, for example, every time you have a tree out there, it, you know, people gravitate and are attracted to the trees because you want to sit underneath that shade. They would prefer to sit under that than under a hot canopy. These trees, there is no reason why these trees had to be trimmed like this. This actually makes it more dangerous. In my professional opinion, if I were to go in there and assess this, I would have those trees just removed. And part of the reason why you have trees that have these high risk or safety issues is because we don't have a program, a post-storm program, to trim the trees after a storm. And this is a technical job. This is not something that anybody can do. You have to have not only the eye, but you have to have the biological training to understand the form and functions of these. It's a living organism, and that's what, how it needs to be treated as such.
Again, just another example of improper pruning. This is the entrance of Naval Station. Again, they just topped it off. And, you know, some of the regulations requires that they have to cut it back 10 feet from the power lines and things like that. The problem with this is that, again, like to what Ronald was saying, understanding the, you know, how trees are going to react and things like that, is that this tree now is going to come back even more flush with weaker branches. And then if we don't need a storm, we just need, you know, these tree winds to go through and moisture and rain, and then it'll drop off, and then it may just impact that infrastructure there. So again, another example of bad practice. Now, I just want to ask you a question, senators, just based on what you see there. Do you think that's a good cut as far as the tree's concerned? No right or wrong answer, just from your... Well, from the untrained eye, right, they look at that and say, that's proper, right? And it looks good, it's a nice clean cut and things like that. However, it's not a proper cut. Because, you know, some of the standards, anything beyond 3 to 4 inches in diameter, the chances of that cut there, the exposure of that would not heal properly. It's just like when you get a cut in your skin, you scab up, right? This thing's not going to scab up. The trees react to that. Mm-hmm. And so if it does not scab up properly and it doesn't seal itself, then now you're exposed to the elements. You got termites, you got insects, you got diseases. So although it's down there, but if a termite goes in there, they start tunneling and they start working way up, and then we don't see it in the outside, at the outside, but you know, there's something that's going on inside, right? Again, this is down at Ipaw. This flame tree, when you get under that tree, it's very intimidating. You see all these huge branches, but people like to park under there, and people like to just sit down, and you know, especially when there's a function or there's high traffic area. This tree here, there are a lot of insect, a lot of the termite tunneling. You got defective branches here. Yeah. So again, here's an issue here. Here's a concern here. Go back to the standards again. This tree. I just hope nothing ever happens to anybody down there.
There should be a warning sign.
Yeah, absolutely.
No, really,
we should just prune it properly.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then we can enjoy the tree.
Yeah. Right.
So this is down at PD. This is this is one of the parks down there. As you can see, improper pruning again, and it's compromising the health and structure of the tree. Those are the same trees today, or yesterday, as of yesterday. I took this picture yesterday. And what I wanted to show you guys, this is what they did a couple years ago, and this is what it looks like today. It looks healthy. It looks really nice and healthy, right? And from the untrained eye, that's what it looks like. However, from the natural resource perspective, that's an unhealthy tree, and that's a tree waiting, an accident waiting to happen. Again, people are going in and out of that area, those areas there. If the right condition exists, somebody's under there, those branches can fall. So that's, we want to change the perception. We want to make people understand that just because it comes back like this, and to my point earlier, that trees are very resilient, that's what that shows there. But it doesn't necessarily mean it's a healthy tree and it's structurally sound. All right? And that's pretty much it. So if you have any questions for the group, or if they want to make any comments.
Yeah.
Thank you, Senator.
Yeah, first I'm sure Senator Underwood agrees. We want to thank you for the initiative that you have. And we understand that while all these things need to be done, for whatever reason, over the years was not done. And like you said, Chief, this is not to point fingers, but it's an opportunity for a clean slate and to try to move forward together. You said that there's current process to approve for permits?
So what it is that contractors or the utility agencies, they come into my office. We have an application. They fill out the application. Obviously, who's doing their tree cutting, then identifying the trees. You know what tree, what species, and how many, and then we do a site inspection. We make the recommendation, and you know whether it's to do the pruning or just doing the crown cleaning or removing just the dead branches, that's how we look at these things. We look at it first at how you can remove the hazards. The last resort is really just total removal unless it's really structurally unsafe or it's really impacting the infrastructure. You know, we do try and work with the utility agencies or whether it's DOE as well. And we do take in consideration.
But that's only if there is a project. But how about for regular maintenance of those trees? There's no process right now. There's
no.
If GVB found some money and wanted to maintain the trees surrounding the Governor Flores Park, right? Would they have to go and get a permit in order to do that?
Well, if cutting or pruning of those trees is required, then yes.
But to your knowledge, there's no regular maintenance of these trees. It's not.
Well, we don't have. It
should be as routine as beach cleaning.
Right.
Yeah.
And again, our role in that whole process, Senator, is really just to when we get the application, we do the site inspection.
But do you have any enforcement authority, or can you go out to GVB and say this tree does not conform in your opinion and make a recommendation that they prune those trees properly? Because I don't always want to be reactionary.
Yeah.
And like I said, what unfortunately happened to that resident who a tree fell on that person caused those mass prunings in the Plaza de España.
Well, as far as the enforcement and the regulations, there are penalties, civil penalties that we can assess.
Civil penalties if they don't follow your recommendation.
Yes, that's correct.
On the permit.
That's correct.
But do you have the capacity right now to go to GVB and say this flame tree, while it looks very healthy, it's not safe for the community?
To answer your question, sir, no.
Why not? Do you need a law to allow you?
And you know, Senator, in the past, I'm sorry, Roland. In the past, I understand that we tried to do that, but you know, there were some roadblocks. So
okay, no, this is why we're talking about this now. So this can all be incorporated into the bill.
Just to give you an update of what's happening, a number of different efforts are happening around the island every day right now with regards to vegetation management. What the tree ordinance will do is help coordinate and standardize how we plant, plan,
including greenways.
It all has to be, it has to be holistic.
Yeah.
An example is, as you're saying, you're asking about GVB. I can tell you now that GVB has already put out a and has a contract for someone to deliver by the end of the year a tree assessment of all the trees along San Vitoris. So they will get a, you know, identify the different trees and figure out their health rating and recommendations per tree. So that's already ongoing. And part of this stems from GVB's desire to elevate the landscape standard in Tumon. On another note, the University of Guam has got a 2025 plan. As part of that, there is already an approved landscaping plan, and there's already an approved listing of plants, trees and shrubs that will go into that 2025 plan. But the University of Guam has already formed an official landscape committee. And so we're already going forward at the University of Guam in setting up, planning a green space areas, and we're looking forward to setting an ordinance on the university campus. Part of what we're doing is also wanting to work with the Department of Agriculture so that as we come together, we harmonize them, and that and it'll assist our efforts. And I will say that we also help with GPA. GPA has and runs annual vegetation management contracts. One of the things that we're having a difficulty with is the fact that if we want to go forward as an island and be on the same lines and conveying the same message with regards to the standards and how this island looks and how we present it to our visitors, as well as how we want our residents to view ourselves, we need to make sure that Parks and Rec, that the Mayor's Council, that the legislature, that GVB, that we all get together.
Including the Hagatnya redevelopment.
Including Hagatnya, which is why they're here as well. So it's important for us to all get into agreement as to what the standards are going to be, and it's important that we get involved at the planning stage, because a lot of times, like you're saying, we don't want a knee-jerk reaction. And what happens is when someone goes in and cuts a tree, that they come back, hey, can you fix this? Well, after you've cut someone's arm off, I just can't attach it. And once again, it has to be viewed from a biological point of view, because that's the only way that we can manage these living organisms.
Is there currently a permit fee? No. What was your recommendation, your working group's recommendation on how to handle this? And then also, what was your recommendation for the penalties? Is there, you just said civil penalties, but it's just very general, right?
Well, that's on the GCA. The penalties are on the GCA, and that. And I would be, maybe somebody in the working group would add to this, but that probably would be incorporated in that. But one of their suggestion or one of the mitigation action was to replace it, except if you remove one tree, then you replace it with two. You know, from our perspective, you know, this is not about trying to impose any penalties or fines to anybody. We want to work with these companies, and that's why it's been a slow process. We want to make sure that, you know, we're not here to find people. That's not my intention. My intention is so they can, you know, when they request for these permits, they're doing it the proper way, and that's all we're asking for. Now, the penalties or all those or anything like that, that's just you know, like an enforcement or management tool, so they know that if they're, you know, there's going to be consequences if they don't do anything. But it is our preferred, it's our desire to not go to that route and just have them do the right thing. It would be our responsibility again to bring the training out, get them trained, get them knowledgeable in what it is that they're doing, and we're in the process of doing that. So once we get them all that information and that the skill set, then we can start and say, hey, you've got the know-how, there's no excuse.
Were you recommending a permit fee?
We've basically been working on what have been the issues, which is why you have challenges and issues, and then you have solutions. So as we thing that we have not worked in and looked in the finer details is fines and fees. We understand that's going to end up coming down the line, but until we figure out exactly what we need the funds for, or you know what would be a reasonable fine, these are the things that have to be vetted, but we have not gone there at this point. The one thing that we wanted to do was, first off, have an idea of how much does GovBOM spend on vegetation management. And from half of the agencies that we've surveyed, a minimum of $3 million. Now, what we're looking at is, imagine if the state of our landscape today is the result of 3 million, and it's probably going to be 5 to 6 million by the time we finish this up. Imagine what it would be like if we do it correctly. Will it cost more? It probably will cost more, but what I'm looking at is not just trying to catch up on the current and maintain our landscape in its current capacity, but I honestly believe that we can take that $3 million or $6 million or whatever it is, and we can actually do more. Rather than concentrating on maintenance, we can actually put some of this money into improving our landscape. But it has to be done holistic. We need to make sure that whatever forestry is doing, it complements the mission and the long-term vision of Waterworks, of GPA, of the Mayor's Council. So we have to get together and come together and do this. Now, it is in the interest of this committee and to get together and also bring in the private sector. Because, you know, one of the things that bothers us is people come back and say, hey, how come we can't look like San Diego? Why is it that everything looks like that in San Diego? It's because they have a standard. And so what we want to do is get to a place where we can have this standard, and the private sector is going to play an important role. So we would like to bring them in, and we have had preliminary discussions. But as we bring that along, it's going to evolve.
And how do you see that happening by way of what kind of legislation? There are several ways we can go. In my mind, we could think about a bill that would, I don't want to say mandate, because we don't have to twist your arms to do what you're very passionate about doing, but we could require the Department of Agriculture within X number of days to develop through the AAA process rules and regulations that will provide for these kinds of tree ordinances and the permits and the processes and then that can be developed. So that way, I think you guys have met outside of any mandate, right? You just came together
Correct.
On your own, which is
Correct.
Something
this is
I
driven by this is driven by stakeholders.
Yeah, something I also encourage is that people have their own initiative and they come together and they don't wait for the legislature or the governor to say, I want you to do this.
And that's the reason why we brought the legislature in on this at the ground
floor. So I want to be clear that I want to continue to give that kind of flexibility and latitude so that you're not boxed in where you have to do certain things within the parameters of that piece of legislation. So my recommendation is very easily, it's easy to develop that kind of structure so you have a mandate to meet. It governor may consider doing this by executive order. We may consider doing this through legislation, and then that way you have an established working group. And I also like the idea that you reached out to DOE to provide for an assessment, like a master plan of all the school facilities. I know Gagne Heights Elementary School has the same problem with that monkey paw tree that's hovering over their structure, and it's actually compromised the integrity of that of their own roofing. But I just don't want you guys to be overwhelmed that if it's a bill that also requires the Department of Agriculture to provide for an overall master plan of an inventory of all the government lands. And it's good that GVB, I'm glad you mentioned GVB is doing that now, but they're doing this absent any standard, so you don't know what their RFP called for. I don't know, because I'm hearing this for the first time. It might behoove this task force to ask GVB specifically, what are the basis of the study which you're commissioning? Are they might just be doing that for aesthetic reasons, that versus that tree that we saw on the picture. That's so we can do that. We could. I mean, I think it's a project
Well, I think what the whole idea is to make sure that
and there'll be a return on the investment.
Yes, and we honestly believe that by going this route, the money that Gov Guam spends on vegetation management would be best spent in this manner as we standardize it.
Now, if the task force is ready, the other route we can go is we could, by way of legislation, adopt the rules and regs into the GAR. And so, you know, we'll have our own public hearings down here. You don't have to wait for the onerous AAA process.
And that's the kind of guidance we want from you.
Guidance in terms of what we can do, but there has to be the continuing conversation, but we would have to look to all of you for guidance. So I just want to commend you for your initiative, because in this short time that I sat here, I didn't realize you've taught me so much about
just to give you an update, as you know, you're asking about the efforts that are happening within Department of Education. Well, the Northern Soil and Water Conservation District has been working with a number of STEM instructors and teachers. And so one of the things that we've been asked to do is provide some opportunities for students to earn service learning. So as a matter of fact, one of the things that we're looking at developing is a module where we can train high school students, and high school students can then do tree assessments on campus, and then therefore that feed into Department of Education as far as their inventory is concerned. And I just think it'd be great, because one of the impediments to service learning with our high school students is the fact that they don't have transportation. So this is perfect. They can do it on campus. It serves the Department of Education, and these students who then pass and test proficiency in being able to conduct a tree assessment can then go and do other schools as well. So we're looking at ways in which we can leverage our resources, and those students are one. We're also hoping that by teaching students and having them learn to do tree assessments, it might open up their eyes and allow them to maybe pursue a field in natural resources.
I'd like to bring up something that maybe wasn't really clear. There are standards, best management practices from ANSI, American National Standards, that are in place that we put into our permitting process to say that they must follow this standard. One of the other things that we wanted to do in the working group was to, there are jurisdictions, just like Parks and Recreation, they have their own. We have our jurisdictions, and the thing about it is that we wanted certified arborists in each of these agencies so that they can have their own quality control. Just like GPA would have their own certified arborist on their staff so that they could oversee the contracts that they're doing, GVB would have their own quality assurance person with the certified arborist training. This year, I'm coordinating with the U.S. Forest Service to have a training on Guam to have certified arborists. I've invited Mr. Shiroma and his staff, DPW, and Parks and Recs, because they are the top three agencies that take care of trees on this island. To do an assessment for the island, I can do it. I can help the agencies do it, but I feel that it is better to have these people in staffed in their agencies to have somebody as a certified arborist in their staff. And I will always be there to help with the training and assisting them. I'm working with UOG to continue the training and the education part. But to have these certified arborists on board is very important.
That's an excellent suggestion, because the bill that we can present to the legislature could also call for a multi-jurisdictional approach to doing this. So, I mean, you guys have all the right ingredients to make this work, so that one particular agency or one particular individual doesn't really have the, you know, they just don't want a situation where it becomes someone's initiative as opposed to your initiative that would benefit the entire community. And I'll be careful to look out for those things. So you're saying other agencies have a certified arborist right now, or that's something we have to work towards?
Right now there are no certified arborists, and I've been working with the U.S. Forest Service requesting that they provide a training on Guam. And that is, we have the opportunity this year in June to actually
aside from all the contracting agencies who probably should go and send some of their staff to go get this or take these exams and become certified.
I was gonna say, find a way to slot someone from GVB in there. GVB, because
GVB does not do the work.
They subcontracted.
They subcontracted.
Yeah, but if they're certified arborists, they can oversee that contract.
Yeah.
Because remember, they're dealing with landscapers, and I don't know to what extent if it's just for aesthetic reasons or if it's for.
Well, LMS does a lot of their contracts, yeah. And they're a private contractor. Maybe they could have one of their staff take the exam and pass and do it. You don't need the training that we're being offered to for.
I don't know how you would offer this to a private sector individual.
No, they can go on their own and do this.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
not. It doesn't take a government entity to ask ISA to take the certification exam. They can do it on their own.
Well, you know, I think, Senator, I think it's at the end of the day, you know, when we bring this thing out, initially bring it out and offer it up to the key agencies, you know, that's the start. And then hopefully it spills over into the private sector coming in and actually, you know, getting that training, because they can also always coordinate with these ISA certified.
Well, how
trainers.
Often are these trainings?
Well, this is upon request. This is not something that is done on a regular basis. We just had an opportunity with the Forest Service. They were able to fund the whole training. And so again, it's just from our perspective. We're looking at it from the government perspective, just the government properties for now.
Yeah, but I was going to ask if the working group will consider,
oh, okay.
As part of the certification, that the landscaper has a certified arborist, because we can do that with these.
One of the things that we discussed in the working group is that if you were to, one of the RFPs would be that you would have on your staff,
correct.
As a private contractor to have a
certified
arborist.
Part of the qualification.
As is us being the government agency, having our own certified arborists so that both sides are compliant. And that's one of the things that we wanted to, you know, implement and put into this bill if it ever comes out.
Any idea how this is received from any, did you present this to any landscaping companies out there?
And when we first, this is the second arborist training that's going to occur on Guam. The first one was done, I think it was in 2002, 2003. And at that time, the private sector was invited to come in because we were moving. That's when we started to work on this ordinance. The thing about that is, the thing you need to understand, Senator, is the fact that this arborist training can be done by anybody. You can do most of this training online. You can take the test locally. So the ability to become certified is within reach of any private company. We actually have a couple of practicing arborists on Guam. Whether they're certified is a different story. All they need to do, realistically, is take an examination. So we have competent people. We have people that are practicing. It's just a matter of, you know, what standard is the Department of Agriculture going to accept? And in this case, they chose ISA. I will let you also understand that part of what is going to happen here by building the Gov Guam capacity with the Certified Arboriculture Program is to allow the University of Guam to have the capacity to teach this as ongoing enrichment or certification courses through the University of Guam. So we will have the capacity, and we will be able to offer credits in order for these people not only to get certified but to maintain their certification. Because you have to maintain so many credit hours, just like teachers do, in order to remain accredited. So Justin has built in the ability to build capacity in the future.
Mr. Santos.
Yeah, thank you for, you know, I laud the efforts of, I'm not part of this working group, or rather my HR is not part of the working group, but I laud the efforts that they're going towards. There are things that I think they should include in the working group, such as land management. As a land use urban planner, to me, the other is the contractor's license board. The contractor's license board has a, there's an actual license called landscaping. And so the, you just have to, there's no criteria or rating to say you, you need to have this type of training. Like for instance, the training with the arborist training, there's no requirement for that to happen. You just have to go in and say, I'm a landscaper, and then you, you take the respective, you get the contractor's license. And so that, that relative to contractor's license board needs, needs to be beefed up. The other things that I see as a recommendation to there, one is the Department of Parks and Recreation is the one that actually has jurisdiction over EPAL or Governor Flores Park.
That's right.
And so where is their management plan? Every park or every area that's a park should have a management plan so that in that management plan they can do the respective know how to do the things like what both Joe Moffness and Roland Kittigua are stating about that they can cut a tree or trim a tree at the appropriate time that it needs to be trimmed, and that, that will be covered in their management plan. That's also aligned with DPW. Title 21, Chapter 53, Section 53, 101 and 102 has about encroachments and about the ability to plant within highways. And most of the properties that, that GPA is, a, is involved in is actually dealing with the highways. It's actually DPW as the proponent is the responsible party for ordering the cutting of trees within the care and protection of highways. And so DPW and DPW is part of this working group, but I don't know if they can their comments came in about the removal of the trees. People are planting under the power pole or power lines, and in reality, DPW could come over and say, you got to remove it, cut it down, remove it out of the way, because then it that makes GPA's work easy in terms of the pruning that they have to go through or the tree cutting they have to go through. You know, again, a management plan needs to be done and using the best management practices that are requisite. The soil and water conservation districts are not a part of this working group, and you know, I'm just wondering why they're not, because they, one of the things we're responsible for, one of the things we look at as our goal is to control erosion, and that's in line with what the statement or the goal.
Well, you meant before, those are all very good comments, Joe, but you mentioned that Parks and Recs has jurisdiction over the Governor Flores Park, which I agree, but yet it's GVB that commissions for the study on the trees that are within that area, right? Does that include
they're only doing Salvatore's Road.
Salvatore's, but does that include the...
It does not include the EPAL Beach.
That's probably why.
Right, again, DPR is responsible for the parks, and
yeah,
every park needs to have a management plan. But if they don't have a management plan, then how do you maintain or do an upkeep of the respective park areas, or bring that up to say this is the cost associated with the maintenance? And of course, you want to have the respective facilities that are required of the park. But you know, part of that park in terms of a furniture is actually the tree itself. And so, if a tree is there, it needs the required maintenance. And lastly, you know, as part of the HORA, you know, we're already doing a master plan. And part of that is included in that master plan is doing the standards of development guidelines. One of the things we need to look at is how do we deal with trees and vegetation, making sure that the right tree and the right plant is planted in the correct area. I mean, we don't want a bougainvillea to be planted in there where it will get in the way of individuals to hurt them in terms of their thorns, versus a tree that's planted under a power pole, or a power pole being put in the wrong place because they didn't, a due diligence wasn't done in terms of where that electrical line needs to be at. And then lastly, in the government of Guam, there's no such position as an arborist. There has to be one created, because in order for GPA, in order for the other line agencies to say, I'm gonna hire an arborist, there needs to be a position within the government of Guam, and that right now there's no position that's created. And so, you know, those are recommendations that I think that the working group needs to look at and include as part of its goal to come up with some type of ordinance. And instead of a tree ordinance, it should be a vegetation ordinance, because you know you have the trees, but then people also plant plants around it. But is it the right plant also in the right area? Would it get in the way? Is it there blocking whatever? But it's a plant and not necessarily the tree itself. And so these are some of the recommendations that I'm saying that the working group needs to look at when they go and proceed forward to come up with some type of ordinance. I think that under the Guam Land Use Commission, there's already the subdivision rules and regs, and the authority for the commission to do a vegetation rules or a tree planting rules or rules dealing with not only the government but the private sector or across the board Guam is actually available within their authority to come up with some type of rules dealing with this. So it links in with the Department of Agriculture's biota or biology of how they deal with trees. So you marry the two, land use and biology. That's why I have to say. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Mr. Santos.
I'd like to address some of the issues that he brought up. The agencies that he brought up, EPA, land management. When I initiated this, I sent letters of invitation to create this working group, and I did send it to land management, to EPA, and to the Guam Contractors Association. They did not identify anybody to be part of this working group. That's why they're not part of this working group. I'm not entitled to force them to join this working group. Another thing is, through our discussion in the working group, GPA and DPW would have rights of ways on certain issues regarding tree management. Certain trees, wrong tree, wrong place, they would go ahead and remove it because it's rights of way. That's one of the issues that was brought up. Why don't they have that? That's one of the things. Also, too, there should be landscaping guidelines. You're not going to plant a certain tree underneath the power line because that does not in the landscaping guidelines. Just as Epaw Beach should have a management plan, they should have follow landscaping guidelines so that they know what tree is in properly should be in the right place. Another thing is you're going to he's saying to forest the arborist position. As a forester, I should be certified arborist. In GPA, they don't have that position, but it could be incorporated into one of the positions to say that one of the positions over there, or somebody supervisory, should have a certified arborist, and that would be good for them. That person would.
Yeah, it's not a position per se, but a certification.
Yeah, a certification to say that
you have some incentive.
This person
in
this agency should have that certification.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. So that's just some things I wanted to address.
Okay. I took some notes here, and let me know if I'm on the right track, because again, I want to do what. I want to make sure Rollins listening so I don't have to repeat myself or he's not going to correct me again. No, let me just, I took some notes, so I want to recap so you tell me if I'm on the right track, because again, the goal of this status hearing is really to see where you guys are at and see what kind of efforts I can lend to this effort as a member of the legislature. I'm thinking maybe a bill that would institutionalize this working group and identify all the members. That's the first step, because as you pointed out, you can send all the letters of invite, but without any clear mandate of them to be part of it, then it's just, it's harder, right, Justin? And then in the bill, we require that every government agency that has jurisdiction over government land provide a management plan. Then you let me know how many days you think or how many months you think they should, if they don't already have this in their inventory, how long would it take to develop one? So those timelines have to be made clear. Identify goals and objectives in the bill, such as the permitting process, adopting the standard that Justin pointed out, the requirement of a certified arborist, to include the requirement for every single landscaping company on the island, which, I'm not saying to landscapers that's the requirement now. They should be part of the working group so we could get their feedback. And then also in the same bill, identified those deliverables like the tree vegetation ordinance. And I think if we present it this way, you certainly will have the mandate, and then we'll identify from the working group, I don't know how often you want to structure it, so how often you meet, and then when you would report, when you would be required to provide for those proposed rules and regs that would either go through the administrative AAA process, which is always preferred, or if you guys have everything together, we can always go that through the legislature and then provide that in the Guam Administrative Rules and Regulations, so we're not putting these rules and regs in the code, in the law, where you would need a future legislature to make the amendment. So that ultimately this task force will be institutionalized, and then part of that also would identify multi-jurisdictions. I like what Justin Santos said, where, you know, the chief, I don't think it's in your mind or in your vision that you want to control everything and you want to see everything, you want to know everything, but just the opposite. You want to have a network of people that can help with this massive undertaking on how these trees should be pruned, what trees should be planted. I mean, for me, it's a big deal, and what I'm hearing this morning is something that is doable, and continue to have the initiative because we could do this, and we can structure this, and we can institutionalize it.
Well, you know, Senator, I mean, I totally agree what you were saying there, that, you know, as government agencies, you know, we're not there to try and dictate or what have you. We initiate, we start the foundation, we establish a strong foundation for, you know, hopefully the private entities would just take it and run with it. And you know, and that, I think that's the way it should work, you know. I mean, we saw a need, we were trying to address that need, and so now hopefully, like you're saying, more people get involved and so they can take the ball. So that's how things will be successful. You know, we're in government, in the government, and, you know, every time things are initiated by the government, it doesn't necessarily work out the way, you know, we would like it to see. So the private sector is a little bit more proficient at doing some things like that. But, you know, we're just trying to get this thing going, and hopefully it gets bigger, and, you know, we start to wean away from the, you know, we still have some sort of oversight, but hopefully that the private sector takes this and carries it and really makes it a successful process.
But I also think, and I hope you would agree, that in this working group, the bill identify you as chair of the working group, because someone has to be the lead. I found that if you make everybody in charge, no one's in charge. So we identify point of contact or a chairperson in the bill, and then you just drive it. And then if this bill gets the support of other 14 members of this legislature and the governor signs it, then there's your mandate. So it's not, you know, it's not anyone taking ownership over what you've done over the last several years, but it's just reinforcing what you guys want to do. So I hope you welcome this status hearing. I know there was some reservations in the beginning about going public with an idea that you had in your arsenal for several years, and I hope you now understand why I thought it was important that we publicly discuss this, so that the community can be aware that there's a method to your madness in terms of all these trees on government buildings.
Yeah, and government land. Absolutely, Senator. You know, we don't do this. You know, we're out there and we're doing the things that we do out there, but we also recognize that we do need your support. You know, we can't move forward without the support of the you know, the legislature and the governor's office. So, and this is just part of that process. And, you know, it's just get out of our comfort zone a little bit. And, you know, but like you said, it's needed, and we do recognize that, and we thank you very much for.
And in the bill, we really should include GPA and University of Guam, Guam Community College, GVB, just generally every agency that the legislature, every agency that has jurisdiction over government-owned land should be. So we can also name them, and then as Justin pointed out, the Contractors Association, they could be members. So as quickly as you can provide me all of the details is as quickly as I can move toward introducing the bill.
We'll continue to work with your staff and your office, and we'll see when we can get that to you as soon as we can.
But from the four things I've read, I think that's, we just fill in the details, right? But that looks like it could be a sound piece of legislation that we can all move forward together on. Anything else, Mayor? Anything else? Congratulations on. I don't know, when were you appointed deputy? This is recent.
It was effective yesterday.
Okay, very recent.
So recent. But I commend the working group. I think they're in the right direction and with your support. With this administration, the governor's really concerned, especially, for example, during liberation time, the trees, how they're out here, and we had that accident, unfortunate accident. So he was very concerned. Also dealing with the Agency of Agriculture, our concern is also the coastal erosion that's happening throughout. So with the proper trimming and all this, that we're preserving the trees and all that, that ties into with a lot. So the governor's concern is please get this going, and we need to work together. So like I said, my second day, and I'm excited to hear what's going on, and these guys have done a tremendous job, and I commend them, and I'd like to be part of it too, and that's why it's important I felt to be here today, whether it was my second day, and just trying to catch up and be educated too on what's been going on. So thank you again.
Okay, thank you. So just to recap, you do have the information I'm asking for, right? The working group, who each consists of, certain goals and objectives, which we reiterated this morning, and the deliverables, and then we can, it's easy to format that into a bill, and then, but I know for the public that's following along, this is unusual that, and I'm happy that we openly discuss an idea, so that it's not discussed for the first time in a public hearing, and then people wonder, what are we doing? Do we want to now tell Ted Maria and Tuno Say what to plant in their yard? So that's not where we're going. It's they're private landowners. That's up to them, provided they're, you know, doing things within the laws that we will allow them to. But in this case, this is strictly government property, as the chief underscored. Okay, anything else? Thank you. Thank you very much.